I speak in the name of Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Take your seats. So, if anyone causes one of these who believes in me to stumble, it is better a stone is tied around his neck and he is thrown into the sea. Or if your hand or foot causes you to stumble, cut it off, as it is better to go through life maimed than enter the fires of hell whole. It's good of Jonathan to give out the easy ones, isn't it? I started thinking about what I would say this morning, and Jonathan last week gave some connection between this week's reading and last week's reading. As I began reflecting on it, I realized that it's quite important to understand what was happening last week. Last week we saw how the disciples, Jesus told the disciples what was going to happen to him in his death and his resurrection. But the thing that the disciples were most concerned about was arguing among themselves about who would be the greatest, who would be the most highly honored. And there's a sense in this where I have a bit of sympathy for the disciples. They were essentially spat out by the Jewish education system. All children in Israel were taught up to the age of 13, and after that, only the best and the brightest, or the children of the most powerful, would go on to train under a rabbi and be honored for that. The rest had to go off and find work wherever they could. So when Jesus calls the disciples, it's almost like a second chance for them to get into that life, to learn under a rabbi, to become a student. They have faced rejection through the system, and now they have been called again. And Jesus doesn't pick an easy group. He picks political extremists who hate the fact that the Roman Empire is occupying Israel, and he also chose a tax collector who works for the Romans, taking money from the Jews. So you could imagine there was a lot of arguing. And they're also probably quite young. So theologians guess that from around the age of 16 up, Jonathan, I don't know if you can remember being that age, but I think you can imagine them being a bit puffed up by being called by Jesus. And they argue among themselves who's going to be the greatest. And in response to this argument, Jesus sits down and he puts a child at the center of the group. He picks up the child and he says, "If you want to become great, you must become like one of these. Anyone who wants to be the first must be the last, the servant of all. And whoever welcomes these children welcomes me." But I'm not sure the disciples really got it last week, because in this week's reading, immediately following that, they become annoyed because someone else was casting out demons in Jesus' name. And the disciples told them to stop. They rebuked them because these other people were not part of the in crowd. They had not been called by Jesus, so how could they be doing these miracles in Jesus' name? They fell into that all-too-human trap of punching down. They've been called to Jesus, but these others haven't. So how can they do those miracles? We know they get petty as they fight over who is best and put others down to make their own position more secure. The disciples have been called, and because of that, they feel they have the right to draw a line of who is in and who is out, who can perform miracles in Jesus' name and who can't. And Jesus tells them off, but they don't really learn this lesson. And the church throughout all of its history also really hasn't learned this lesson. We have, throughout our history, drawn our lines of who is in and who is out, and those lines change over time. But the church, like the disciples, still fall prey to this very human tendency of wanting to assert itself, to make its place more secure by being exclusive, to know who is in and who is out, usually at the expense of someone else. Now, the first striking part of this reading is in Jesus' words about hell. It's not something we like to talk about often, But Jesus does talk about it, and I think from time to time we have to. And hell is one of those things that the church has used over its history to say who is in and who is out. In our Bibles, the Greek word translated into hell is Gehenna. And Gehenna was an actual physical place near Jerusalem. It was the city dump. It was like the one at Freeman's Common, but probably better signposted. But not only that, in Israel's history, it was where child sacrifices were made to pagan gods, usually by fire. Judean kings would sacrifice their children to pagan gods on this place. So when Jesus talks about the fires of hell, he's recalling this horrifying language and this horrifying image of this place near Jerusalem. What we think of when we think what happens after death is very different from what Jesus had in his mind. The Jewish concept of what happened was more that you just fell asleep and you just await the resurrection in the last days. Now the church picked up this language, and a medieval politician, Dante, wrote a book about hell, which has kind of set the vision for how we think of it today, out of fire and pointy sticks. And since then Christianity has used the fear of hell as a way of gaining power and obedience and generating income, it became a tool to determine who was in and who was out, to make those on the inside feel better about being in, and those on the outside want to be in. The second striking thing about this passage is Jesus' words, "If your eye causes you to sin, gouge it out. Or if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off." I think I can say with some relative confidence that Jesus is not speaking literally here. I have that confidence primarily because Jesus didn't go around Jerusalem dismembering people. He did the exact opposite. He went around restoring people's sight, strengthening their hands and strengthening their feet so they could walk. So what does Jesus actually mean with these words? It seems like one of those things that Jesus does when he goes over the top in explaining his point. Like on the Sermon on the Mount, when he says that just being angry with someone is the same in God's eyes as murdering them. It's like he could also be poking fun at the Pharisees here, who the Pharisees would take one law in Jewish scripture and they would say, in order to not break this law, you can't do this. And in order to not do that, you can't do this. So they expanded the prohibitions about what you could or could not do. And so Jesus maybe is kind of poking fun of them here. He's saying, you know, if you don't want to sin, just cut off your hand. To point out the ridiculous extremes to which they have been pushing people. But I think the main point Jesus is getting at here is that we can try our best to achieve what is good and right, but at the end of the day, for all our trying, God looks at the heart. Not what we can achieve with our hands, not all of our well-thought-through plans or successes or losses. God looks at who we are. And I think Jesus says these things because he knows that they are near impossible for us to follow. And in the face of an impossible task, all we can do is return back to God's love and grace for us. And because of this, because God doesn't look at what we do or what we can do, it's why we can't draw lines as the disciples did and as the church has done through history about who is in or who is out, who is part of us or who is not, because it's not about what we do. It's simply about the fact that we are here together. It's why we should resist the temptation that the disciples fell into to push each other down, and instead we should be raising one another up to see the blessings in one another. It's why we are called to show hospitality to all who come and not condemn others to fear of what might happen to them if they do not come, if they do not join us. It's the reason why everyone is welcome, because there is no greater or lesser person in God's house. And there is nothing any of us can do to make ourselves greater or lesser in God's eyes. All we can do is to give to others the grace and the blessings that we ourselves receive from God. We put our faith in God as a righteous judge who will do justice, because justice is required. You know, bad things happen, and for that we do need to understand something of the concept of hell and of justice. But that is God's. It's not our place to deny anyone access to Jesus. I want to end with some words from Teresa of Avila, who was a Spanish Carmelite nun in the 1500s. She writes, "Christ has no body now but ours, no hands, no feet on earth but ours. Ours are the eyes with which he looks compassion upon the world. Ours are the feet with which he walks to do good. Ours are the hands with which he blesses the world. Ours are the hands, ours are the feet, ours are the eyes. We are his body." Just end with a simple prayer. Heavenly Father, as we eat and drink at your table this morning, may you hold us together as one. May we become your body and invite others to you. Amen.